First of all, I'm really glad to have the honor to give the opening speech at Elevate Festival. At the same time, it's very difficult to give an opening speech before a party, because I know a lot of people, including me, are waiting keenly for the party, which will take place just after my speech. And, well, I'm not bringing good news. I'm bringing bad news. But first of all, I want to say something about the organizers and about the Elevate Festival. Out of my own experience of organizing festivals, as some of you may know, I organized a big festival in Croatia, which was called the Subversive Festival, where people such as Alexis Tsipras, Oliver Stone, the daughter of Che Guevara and so on were coming for almost 10 years. And I was really glad to see Daniel today picking me up by a car just several hours before he entered the stage. And as someone who organized the festival, I know how much it means that a festival didn't get professionalized, commercialized in that way that even the organizer is able to greet all the guests, have a drink with them, and even pick up at Autobahn A2 or the Zovas. So I hope that Elevate will stay like that. And I think in these times, it's really subversive to take the money of the European Union and actually give the space to someone as me and to someone who co-founded DiEM, Democracy in Europe movement, together with Yanis Varoufakis, and actually to speak about, to criticize the current state of the European Union. I also think it's very important that such festivals try to combine, and they succeed to combine, parties, music, and discourse, and critical thought. Because I think one of the big failures of the left today is precisely, except Bernie Sanders or Jeremy Corbyn in the UK, to some degree Syriza or what was Syriza and Podemos, that the left is not able to relate and to mobilize the young people between 20 and 35. It's usually the right who is succeeding. So to come to my speech or whatever it is, Europe is collapsing, and this is no news anymore. But somehow we are still living as if this is not happening, and we are comfortably sitting in our seats, and we are partying, although we are sitting at the edge of an abyss. We know very well that more than 1 million refugees entered the European Union in the last 1 year, but we are still living as if this is not happening. We know very well that the extreme right is rising all over Europe, not anymore only in Greece or in Spain or in UK, but also in Austria, also in France, also in Germany. But we are still partying and living our lives as if this is not happening. We know very well that economic policies are destroying whole populations, especially on the periphery of the European Union, but now with labor reforms also in France and in the center of Europe. We know very well that wars are still going on in Libya and in Syria, and that new wars, especially with Hillary Clinton, are just around the corner. But we are still living our lives. In psychoanalysis, this is called fetishist disavowal. It's called denial. And someone who explained this situation, this kind of mental amnesia, mental handicap, mental blindness, who explained it the best way I can imagine, it's Franz Kafka. So in August 1914, when the war just broke out, he wrote in his notebooks, Deutschland hat Russland den Krieg erklärt, nachmittags Schwimmstunde. In English, Germany had just declared the war to Russia. In the afternoon, I will go for swimming. Well, we are not so lucky to be brilliant minds as Franz Kafka, and we don't write so good books. But still, what we do very well is to have the luxury to go swimming in the afternoon, to go partying, to read books, and so on. But the new war might just be around the corner. And today, we find ourselves in a similar situation. Sometimes to realize that this is not science fiction, what I'm talking about, we have to look precisely at science fiction. Recently, and since this is also an arts and cultural festival, I have to mention it, and I hope you invite this guy the next year, because I think this was the most incredible exhibition I have visited this year. In May this year, I was invited to Athens to give a talk about an exhibition, about an artist from Belgium, and so on, and I'm usually bored by this stuff. But I went there because I met my friend Yannis, so we were developing some subversive plans for democratizing Europe. And I thought it would be just another boring exhibition where artists invite philosophers and theorists just to build up their discourse and to sell it better to the audience. But it wasn't like that. So a Belgian artist who is called Thomas Belling, I don't know how many of you know about him, so Google him. It's a Belgian theater director who made something which is called the Museum of European History in Exile. So you come to Athens, to a huge building, which is a former building of the Ministry of Labor, which is now under the Tsipras government, of course, being privatized and sold. And you come to the building, you enter the building, it's completely empty, it's five floors, and you enter a museum of European history. So Yannis and me come together to the museum. They first say, okay, guys, you cannot go together to the museum, because the idea is that you walk alone through the museum. And first, when you come to the museum, you come to a room where you see a big map of Europe from the perspective of the future. So it's a perspective of Europe's history and of Europe's finite, of Europe's disintegration, out of the perspective of 2018. You see a map of Europe and you see it's completely collapsing. So I start walking around the building. First, what you visit is the European community of coal and steel, which was, as you know, the foundation of the European Union, founded in 1952. You see this, you walk around, you see the foundation of the euro, you walk around to the second floor, you see the foundation of Maastricht, Lisbon, and so on. And then at one floor, because I think Yannis was very quick, we meet. And we meet in 2015. We meet in 2015, which was, of course, the year of the Athens Spring. And we meet in front of a map of all the flags of all the right-wing extreme parties all around Europe. And this was before all these parties became something which might be called the extreme center. So you come to a room and you see all the flags from Golden Dawn to Marine Le Pen, AfD, FPÖ, and all the parties all around Europe. And Yannis and me say, as someone, of course, we are self-critical, because I think we have to be self-critical today, we say the only thing what is missing is the flag of Diem. As those idiots and those utopians who tried to change something but didn't succeed. And then you go to the other room, you see that Britain has exited the European Union already. I warn you, this was May, this was much more before Brexit. You see the refugee crisis, you go further, you see a civil war in Europe, and you come to 2018, and you see that Europe is collapsed. So I pose you the question, is this science fiction, or is this already happening? The exhibition and that this idea was already proved with Brexit. And only if you look at Greece today, you will see most of the problems of the European Union today. So at that time, I visited Greece very often. So first I visited, of course, when you land to Greece, you land to the airport. But did you know that 14 airports of Greece were sold to Fraport under the Tsipras government? Then you enter the port Piraeus, which is one of the most strategic ports in the Mediterranean, and you go there, and when I visited there, you can find two sides of the same port on the Greek territory. In one part, you see the workers which are striking for 20 or 30 days. That was in June, I think. And they're striking because they fear they might also be sold to the Chinese. And then you see what is the problem. On the other part, 67% of Port Piraeus is already sold to a Chinese company which is called Costco. So in that part of Greece, which is now China, the workers don't have collective bargaining rights, they don't have a right to form trade unions, they have lower wages and so on. So what you actually have inside of Europe is capitalism with Asian values, which has nothing to do with Asia, it's about capitalism without democracy. And then, if you go to France, you will find, for instance, a new movement which is called Nuit Debout. And Nuit Debout is a reaction to Hollande's labor reform, which is actually trying to implement the very same measures which are experimented in Greece. If you move forwards from Athens to Thessaloniki, you will, of course, come to Idomeni. When I came to Idomeni, we were shooting a movie for Al Jazeera, and we were trying to shoot the, not to shoot, but to film 15,000 refugees who were camping in Idomeni refugee camp. And we came there, and there were no refugees at all. So we asked one refugee who came with us to Idomeni what's happening, and he told us, you know why we were occupying the railway tracks at Idomeni? We were occupying the railway tracks at Idomeni because we realized that strategically, this is something which can really hurt the economic system. And then we pose a danger, and then maybe there is a big sign in Idomeni which says hope, then we might have hope that we might enter the center of the European Union. What was the problem? 50,000 of refugees were occupying the railways, which is the main road to Western Balkans and to center of Europe for now Chinese goods which come from Port Pirus. So what you can see in Europe again is that unlike what the, you know, the famous anthem of the European Union says, alle Menschen werden Brüder, all people will become like brothers, but what you can see, you know, goods will become like brothers, you have a free floating of capital, but refugees cannot enter the European Union. And then just several weeks after that, I went to the refugee camp, which is called the jungle, Calais in France. And you face a very similar situation, which tells a lot about European Union. And I think this is a symptom of a crisis, which is so deep that it might bring us really into a collapse of the European Union. So you see the jungle with more than 10,000 refugees, and it's not being cleared, as they try to convince us through mainstream media. And then you have something which is called the Eurotunnel. And the Eurotunnel was a big architectural achievement, a big economic achievement, to try to, actually they succeeded to bring closer France and UK, in economic terms, of course. And I had a chance to speak to the PR chief of Eurotunnel, asking him very naive questions. So with those guys, you don't have to do critical theory. You just pose very naive questions and they will tell you everything. The best critical theory you can find. Ideology without the masks. So we were standing in front of a big fence, and he was very proud to say, can you see these fences here? This is NATO standards. They use it in Germany when the G20 protests are happening and so on. And I ask him, so why are you using it here? Well, we are trying to pull off the refugees to enter the tracks. And then you have a new perversity which will bring us closer to TTIP and TISA and CETA, which is called the ISDS, which is called the Investor State Dispute Settlement. So Eurotunnel used the ISDS in order to sue France and UK in order to get the money of the British and French taxpayers to pay to build the fences to get rid of the refugees. And if you ask me, this is wrong with Europe today. And this is just the refugee crisis. What we could have seen with Brexit is that we have a new danger in the European Union today. Europe is not a promising project anymore. You have countries such as Britain exiting, you have countries such as Hungary or Poland threatening to exit. You have Marine Le Pen, who might come to power in France, who is also threatening to exit the European Union. And if you remember what Robert Schuman said before the foundation of this community in 52, he said that what they are trying to do is to bring closer Germany and France in order to prevent wars. So if France exits the European Union, I think we can imagine precisely the scenario out of the science fiction exhibition what we have seen. But I think as the left, we have to be critical as well. And that's something which I think many of my and our left-wing comrades who still stick to the idea of Lexit, which is a left exit, don't realize. They don't realize that there is no outside of capitalism. When Brexit was happening, I had the chance to be at the Ecuadorian embassy with Julian Assange, who did a Brexit TV show. And in front of us at the table were all the main newspapers from Britain. And there was one which particularly caught my eye. It was the Daily Sun, you know, the Daily Sun in Britain. And the title of the Daily Sun was Independence Day. Of course, they were at the same time promoting the science fiction movie, the second part of the movie. And I think most of the left also bought this idea that an Independence Day is possible, that it's possible to get outside of capitalism. Well, I have to bring the bad news. 1 month ago, I had the opportunity to be in Silicon Valley. I'm telling this just to show that I'm not just a philosopher, but I try to see things which are happening. And in Silicon Valley, just one day before I came there, a guy who is called Elon Musk, I think most of you heard about him, Tesla Motors and so on, had a lecture about occupying Mars. So they're not trying to go to Mars, like, to bring peace and so on. They call it Occupy. Not as Occupy movement, of course. They think about Mars as colonization. So I think the problem with Lexit and Brexit is that even if you think that you will exit an island such as Britain, they will already be on Mars. And someone here mentioned Airbnb or Uber and so on. What you can see with Google and Facebook and all big Silicon Valley companies is precisely that they are penetrating all areas of our daily lives. What Airbnb and Uber are doing is actually commodifying human relations. And I think this is the problem. So if we really believe that we can exit this system, I think this is one of the most dangerous illusions. You can see it here in Austria. Those who speak about security, those who speak about immigrants, they're trying to sell us the idea that it's possible to live in an island, also we are already part of global capitalism. And this is the problem, that today, and I think this is the biggest problem the left has to face today, that constantly we are faced with false dilemmas. Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, Erdogan or the military coup, Theresa May or Nigel Farage, Uber or Facebook. And I think this is the biggest problem, that what the left has to do today is actually to create a new way of a third way. When I say a third way, this is not a Blair third way. What I think we have to build today is a progressive international movement. It's not that we didn't have these experiences before. I come from Yugoslavia. We had the non-aligned movement, which was not just Yugoslavia. We had the World Social Forum. But I think what is missing today is precisely to bring a kind of superstructure which would bring together the experience of so-called rebel cities, what you have in Barcelona or Naples, which would bring together the local communities, municipal experiences like cooperatives, like Bitcoin, if you want, although we might be critical of Bitcoin as well, which might bring together horizontal experiences of horizontal democracies such as Syntagma Square, Nuit Debout, Occupy Wall Street, and so on. On the other hand, which might bring together political parties such as the Labour Party in Britain. But I think what we are still missing in Europe, and I think I was not paid to do that, I think Elevate Festival, Resonate, and some other festivals are going in that direction, although there is much work to do, is precisely to do this. If you heard some of the previous speakers, they were telling that after this festival, there will be another festival, there will be another festival. Some of these speakers and some of the DJs and so on are going from one festival to the other festival. Of course, let me be cynical here. What we have to avoid is frequent flyer activists flying from one festival to the other festival, getting fees and so on. But what it shows is that we can use the money of the European Union. We can use means of technology, as we have seen with Sarah Harrison speaking from I don't know which location. Of course, what they can do, what they did with Julian Assange, is to cut down the internet. And I think you should all follow WikiLeaks and what is happening with Julian Assange today, because what they are trying to do is silence someone who is trying to reveal some really dirty secrets about Hillary Clinton, who might come and who would probably come to power in US, which will influence all of us. But I think what we have to do today is to use our imagination, to use technology, to use festivals as Resonate, And as Elevate, yeah, well, it's not Resonate here, it's Elevate, yeah, right? Well, I have been to too many festivals, I think, right? So it was really my honor to open this festival. I hope to see you at the party as well. If you are looking for progressive answers and for subversive answers, I suggest you to follow WikiLeaks and DiEM25. Thanks a lot.